Our Town, West Warwick is made possible by the following premier sponsors.
Centerville Bank, providing a wide array of financial services since 1828. Proud supporter of Rhode Island PBS, Our Town, West Warwick, and the community.
And
John J. Clark Insurance, established in 1928, committed to the West Warwick community and beyond, conducting business with integrity and professionalism.
And the following patron sponsor.
Iannotti Funeral Home.
When you look for West Warwick on the map, you can find it right in the middle of the state. West Warwick is a small town, just under 8 square miles, but has a big population, about 30,000 residents. Many of those who live here were born and raised in West Warwick, and their families go back for generations. There's a lot of pride in this town and much diversity. West Warwick was originally part of Warwick, but this old mill town with many factions and many ethnic groups fought to stand on its own. West Warwick became its own entity, the last of Rhode Island's cities and towns to incorporate. It was 1913. That's where the people of West Warwick begin their stories with their vision and their voice. This is Our Town, West Warwick.
The Great Divide was signed into law by Governor Aaron Pothier on March 14, 1913. It made West Warwick the 39th and last municipality in the state of Rhode Island.
Patrick Henry Quinn was the leader of the revolt against the city of Warwick. And the reason was that all of the mills were in West Warwick. Not all of them, but a lot of the mills were in West Warwick, and a lot of the people that worked in the mills, a lot of immigrants, French Canadian like myself, and the Irish and the Portuguese and the Italian immigrants who worked at all of those mills, the leaders felt that they were being underrepresented by the city of Warwick, and they broke away in 1913 and formed the town of West Warwick. So West Warwick is the oldest, newest town in the state of Rhode Island, and these people who eventually became the first town council sat in that office with Patrick Henry Quinn and plotted the overthrow of of Warwick, and led to the government of the town of West Warwick. And at that time, Warwick was predominantly a Republican city. A lot of landowners, a lot of farms, a lot of wealthy folks that owned mills, and West Warwick was kind of the immigrant population of the city of Warwick along the Patuxent River, where all of the Knight Mills were and the Royal Mills, which people know right now, and the Arkwright Mills and the Riverpoint Mills and the Arctic and Centerville Mills. And so it was just natural for them to say, look, we want to break away from Warwick at that time.
Once the division occurred, Governor Pothier, besides signing the Great Divide Bill, set up a commission to determine the assessments of each newly formed town and to divide all debts and to pay the bills. So the new town of West Warwick obtained the Warwick High School, which was located in Westcott Village. It's now a elderly housing building. And a new town hall was set up on Pike Street in Riverpoint by the Pike family. They converted their mansion into the town hall. The final financial tab for this division was that West Warwick, which had the industrial base, accounted for a little over 37% of Warwick's total assets and debt, or more than $320,000. It's hard to believe that West Warwick escaped with significantly less of the bill, because the eastern sector, Warwick, obviously had almost 63%, but that's politics.
The Crompton Mills in the section of West Warwick that's nearest to East Greenwich was the velvet capital of the world. All the velvet not all the velvet, but most of the best velvet was made there along the banks of the river in Crompton, and sections of Arctic and sections of River Point and sections of Phoenix and Natick were all different types of mills, but mostly textile mills. Some jewelry manufacturing, but a lot of textile mills. Fruit of the Loom got its start along the Patuxent in West Warwick and Warwick. So a lot of the brands that we know of really got the start from mills there. And the mills were the center of everything. I mean, all of the homes along next to the mills. The mills at that time really provided a lot of opportunity, not only for work for immigrant families, like in my case, my grandparents from Canada, but also for, they had the mill stores, and they had the everything centered around the mill. And you know, people would walk to the market, walk to this, walk to that, and it kind of settled into the rich ethnic and cultural heritage that is West Warwick now, in that, you know, one section of town near a certain mill would be predominantly Italian, and in Arctic it would be predominantly French Canadian, and in Natick it could be Irish and Polish, and in River Point and it would be Portuguese. So the families settled there, and it's not by any coincidence they would send buses to Canada to recruit people to come work in the mills, because it was a shortage.
My name is Stuart Benton. I'm the president and CEO of Bradford Soap. We were founded in 1876 by two gentlemen by the names of Rogers and Murgatroyd. They came over from Bradford, England. Bradford, England was the textile industry of the world at the time, and they came to Rhode Island because Rhode Island, and specifically this area, was the textile industry of the New World. So they created this little soap company, and they called it Bradford Soap. You know, the biggest reason we've been able to survive 140 years is, number one, we've been able to change with the time. So, you know, for the first 60 years, we really did flake soap, and then we went into textile soaps and supplemented it with fire retardants and soap to put on paper to make it glossy, and then we got into bar soap. And we were really the preeminent company that's out there doing specialty bar soaps. In the 1950s, Alan Howland, who is the grandfather of the families that own the business today, got involved in the business. And in the 1960s, we started to develop fine toiletry soap as a base, and then the ability to press that soap. So since about the 1960s through today, we're in the specialty bar business, where we're pressing soaps for companies all over the world, predominantly in North America. We've developed the intellectual property for this, and we own that technology, but we have, we create a specific brand for each customer. You can almost consider bar soap a two-phase process. So the first phase, which really makes us pretty unique, is that we saponify our own noodles. So saponification is where we're taking coconut oil, palm oil, tallows, and we put a little caustic with it and a lot of heat, and we create a soap noodle. We've created over 50 proprietary bases of soap noodles. And there's really two universes of soap. There's what I'll call all natural and healthy, and then there's the science side. On the healthy side, or the natural side, this is where you take 100% of the veggie soaps, and you combine with that all natural ingredients and additives. So we've had a history of developing new products with the cutting edge fragrances, cutting edge all natural ingredients, and there's a huge consumer group out there that loves the all natural product. We were the first organically certified soap mill in the country. We're the only soap company in the world using a soap derived out of Rainforest Alliance noodles. We use palm oil coming right out of Guatemala that's been certified by the Rainforest Alliance. And so we put that into soap. And so we know it's sustainable. We know it's being sourced properly. And then our customers get to put the little green frog on. So it's pretty cool. really how we survived and how do we continue to survive is we've really been a very innovative company, taking a very, you would think, very simple product being soap and making it very exciting and giving people a reason to want to buy different varieties of soap. You know, one of the great things about being here in Rhode Island are the people. We've been here 140 years. Our building is beautiful. It's one of the last active, it is the only last active mill on the Patuxent here. We take great pride in that. It's a registered building in the National Historic Register. The people have great experience, and like I said, they've had a huge history. They're part of what we deliver. We really can't deliver the products that we do without the people. And then just the experiences of Rhode Island and New England and what it has to offer as a lifestyle is really super. So that's really the greatest benefits of being here in West Warwick.
Edna is 95 years old and currently resides at the Cedar Crest Nursing Home. In 1988, Edna wrote a book titled The House on Maple Avenue, which tells a story about her life in West Warwick from 1931 to 1957.
Her book that she wrote in the 1980s, explains what life was like in West Warwick when she was a young girl and growing up in West Warwick during the Depression with a single mom. Her mother was a single mother of six, and what they did to survive.
The house was located across from a mill, the last of four of the same device. It was a duplex of seven rooms with a mirror image on the other side. By today's standards, it would be considered roughing it, with only one bathroom and no hot running water for eight people. But we didn't feel disadvantaged because we were used to living that way, and most of our family and friends lived that way as well.
The mill was directly across from our house, made of red brick, and had ivy growing up the walls. There were about 20 lace machines on the first floor, and in summer, with the windows open, we could hear the constant rumble of machinery. The mill dominated our lives. Most of the men in our neighborhood worked there or in the lace trade in other mills nearby. Few people owned cars prior to World War II, so they needed to live close to work. The mill whistle blew at 8 a.m., 12 noon, and 5 p.m., and we arranged our lives around it. No matter where we were playing, when the 5 o'clock whistle blew, we knew it was supper time.
Just prior to our moving there, the cotton mills closed and moved south after bitter strikes by the workers who worked under horrible conditions back then. Many of these people took jobs in the lace mills, which was a big industry. The shopping district, called Arctic, was in the center of town on Main Street. Many people came from the surrounding communities to shop, as this was the place with the most stores in one location. Our parents weren't very strong Catholics, but made sure we were raised in the religion. Priests were honored as God's right hand, and no one questioned their authority. Sunday was a real day of rest, with most people attending church, then having a big dinner at noon. In the afternoon, we went to the movies at the theater on Main Street, while our parents relaxed at home in the yard, reading the Sunday paper. Sunday was also the day our relatives came to visit. Although few people had cars, the ones who did would pile everyone in who wanted to go for a drive.
When the lace trade went into a slack period, as it often did, Pa decided to move to Seekonk, Massachusetts, to help Uncle Henry on his farm. The plan was for them to raise chickens and vegetables, and Pa would peddle the goods around the neighborhood. That endeavor didn't work out well, as Pa wasn't a very good farmer. So as soon as the lace mills were busy again, Pa went back to work.
Pa worked the morning shift the day before he died. He complained of chest pains after lunch, and Mom must have thought it was serious because she called the doctor. Old Dr. Harrop gave him some medicine, which seemed to help, but he died in his sleep during the night.
Mom managed the same way her mother did, by taking her oldest son out of school. and both he and she went to work in the lace mill. There were times when she hardly knew where our next meal was coming from, but somehow she kept us fed and clothed. In spite of her hard life, Mom was a cheerful person, singing and laughing at work. People who worked with her used to say that if they didn't know her situation, they would think she hadn't a care in the world.
The railroad went right through the heart of West Warwick, right into Providence, and then down through West Warwick, and then right into Connecticut, and eventually to New York, and eventually to Washington. So it was a main thoroughway. And I think people forget how important it was. All the goods that were brought to West Warwick were brought by train.
This is my great-grandfather's application for employment. You can see there, New York, New Haven, Hartford Railroad. James Powell was born in Ireland in 1840.
He set up the family homestead on Washington Street. He was originally a farmer, and then he worked for the railroad, and his three sons, one by one, all started to work for the railroad, each at a different railroad station. When my great-grandfather retired in 1893 is when my grandfather took over his post. And at that time, his two brothers were already working at two other different depots. But that's when my grandfather took over his post, and he worked there for over 55 years. My grandfather, his little shelter was a small shelter. He was more of a station agent, a crossing agent, where he would stop the trains, clear the tracks, watch out for, try to prevent accidents. There was also records of him working with detectives on how to solve break-ins and anybody tampering with the lines. And so he had a variety of responsibilities.
We have some lanterns that hung on the porch in our family home for many years. There are some pictures here about the different signals with the different lights, the trains. I'm somewhat confident that my grandfather probably had this in his jacket pocket for reference over the years of his service.
He retired with over 50 years of service, and that's just a letter testifying to that. Talks about his pension, which was $40 a month back then, which I guess wasn't too bad for that era.
I have one picture in particular that really makes me wonder, because I look at it and I see people getting on and off the train, hustling and bustling and talking and chatting, and I think, I know that train is on its way to the depot where my grandfather worked or my great uncle worked. And I wonder if, I look at those people and I wonder if any of them said hello to my grandfather, my great grandfather, or if they were greeted by my great uncles or they had a conversation with them. Today, my youngest daughter lives in Connecticut and the same track goes right behind her property. And so you could walk from her house today in Connecticut and go right by my house, continue on, go by all three and four depots where my ancestors lived, right to the backyard of where my mom and dad grew up and where my great-grandfather raised his family in the 1800s. So we're all connected through the railroad. I know when I go on the bike path today, I just kind of walk and look and think what it must have been like to be on a train and then see a town coming up ahead and opening up to an area where people are hustling and bustling and unloading wood and grain and then going back in through the woods again. Just a whole different way of life. My great-grandfather, James, was also on the committee that helped establish the founding of St. James Parish. Grove Hall, which was on Main Street, next to the Clark, Kendall, and Bradley building, which isn't there anymore, that was eventually transferred into the first original St. James Church. Okay. And then later on, they purchased the property on the side of that and built the second St. James Church. Originally, the Irish went to St. Mary's in Crompton, and it started getting overrun by the French. And in one of the books on the history of West Warwick, there's a story about how there was a ruckus on Veterans Square Bridge between the French and the Irish, where they actually showed up with billy clubs, and they were battling it out because the Irish were upset that their church was being taken over by the French. So they were like, it's our church. No, it's our church. So they went to Father Gibson, who was the pastor at St. Mary's, and they said, this is supposed to be an Irish church. We're getting taken over by the French. And he went to Bishop Hendrickson. And Bishop Hendrickson is the one who got the diocese to form. B- because of that incident, they created St. James Parish specifically for the Irish. Grove Hall first was a meeting place for Irish to meet, to entertain, to hold dances. My great-grandfather used to run the dances there, and then eventually that ended up becoming the first St. James Church. Sadly, ironically, my father, who kept true to his roots, you know, his St. James Church, he went to school there, he and his brothers and his sister, all of us went to school there, have so many stories of St. James. When the time started to change, and when we were kids in the 50s and 60s, everybody was, their way of life was all associated with the church. Everything you did revolved around the church. As the time started to change in the 70s, my father was on the committee that ultimately had to decide that the parish had to close. So it was very heartbreaking for my dad to be on the committee when his grandfather and father were ones that actually helped to start the parish. Yet my father, had to make the heartbreaking, wasn't solely his decision,
right,
but he was on the committee that had to make the decision that it was time to close the parish. They tried everything to keep the parish open. And they, for years, they said, you know, they used to let kids who belonged to the parish could go to the school for free. Then they changed that. They had to pay a fee as well. Then the school closed. And then the parish population just started decreasing more and more, and they didn't have enough funds. I know one of the priests was known to give money to anybody who showed up at the door and needed money. The priest would give away money, and both of my parents used to be the collectors, where they would collect the money and help the priest keep track of the finances. And gradually over the years, they just realized more and more they were just getting more and more in debt. And like many of the other parishes in West Warwick, same thing was happening. When the church closed, we were all allowed to walk through there. And it was really bittersweet for my family, because we used to clean the vestibule. We used to set up the priest's vestments, put the candles in the little candle thing, dust the statues. I can remember dusting statues and finding little notes, little prayers that people would write on a piece of paper and put tucked behind the statue. So it was heartbreaking for us to walk through the church for the last time. And literally, they closed the doors behind us. And we walked with my dad and his brother, and then carried the statue of St. James over to St. John's because they were merging the parishes. The Union Cornet Band provided entertainment for the community in the 1800s. It got its name as a Union Cornet Band from the Civil War. My great uncle John was the band director. My grandfather was the treasurer and secretary at different times. They performed in Arctic, they performed in Phoenix, they performed in East Greenwich. They played at funerals, all kinds of events, political events. They were the main attraction, the main form of entertainment for the day. The Union Cornet Band is responsible for getting my grandfather and grandmother together, because she used to go and listen to the music and they started corresponding. My grandfather was a clarinetist, and my great uncle was a cornetist. And my grandfather, the clarinetist, was the one who used to entertain people in the area. When he was sitting at the depot waiting for the trains to come, he would practice his clarinet. There were a lot of people from Quidnick, which they called it, because it was not West Warwick per se then, it was Western Warwick. But there were people from Quidnick, there were people from the western area of Warwick. We have books that have a list of all the people that were members, but it wasn't it wasn't anything that they got paid for, it was something that they enjoyed doing. growing up in West Warwick in the 50s and the 60s, for us, it was very idyllic. Everything revolved around the church and your family. But the May processions were a big deal, and the first communions were a big deal. And my father used to love to take home videos. As children, we played with all those instruments. And then when my father showed us, started bringing out all the old pictures, and we saw the pictures of the same instruments that we used to play with, we used to dress up in the uniforms for Halloween, you know, and use, because we had little remnants of the little jackets that they used to wear and the hats that they used to wear. But we had the tuba and a lot of the cornets and the drumsticks and the cymbals and the piano. We all learned to play the piano on that. They were all just left in the house, and we used to play with them as kids.
In the late 1800s, Arctic was a community of mainly French-Canadian immigrants, drawn here to work in the booming textile industry, the mills. Since the immigrants were predominantly Catholic, St. John's Parish, led by the Father, the Reverend Joseph G. Bourgeois, became the very heartbeat of the community. Father Bourgeois was an educated, forward-thinking, dynamic man who was deeply invested in the lives of his parishioners. As a young priest, Father Bourgeois had developed a great love of music and theater when he visited Europe, seeing productions of famous French plays and attending musical concerts. This love and appreciation of the arts stayed with him his entire life. So when he looked for a way to enrich the lives of his parishioners, he knew theater and music were a perfect way to do it. The Odeon was the culmination of Father Bourgeois' mission to fill the lives of his parishioners with something more than weaving and fabric and spindles. In 1909, Father Bourgeois purchased the old cadets' hall and enlisted local carpenter Calixte Joseph Couteau to build the Odeon. Life was hard in those days, and to enjoy a night at the theater was a ray of sunshine in an otherwise bleak world. Not only could locals attend concerts, plays, lectures, and the like at the Odeon, they became, with the help of Father Bourgeois, the actors and musicians performing on that grand stage. Classic French plays were performed by mill workers, housewives, and grocers. People came from all over New England and as far away as Canada to see Father Bourgeois' productions. One day, Father Bourgeois heard a young lady sing. Her name was Lucia Chenon. He was so impressed by her talent that he urged her to pursue a singing career, which she did. She began taking singing lessons and eventually studied for 3 years in Europe. Upon her return to America, she was to make her debut in New York City, another incredible accomplishment for a young lady from Arctic. However, as fate would have it, plans changed when Miss Chenon's father, Jean-Baptiste Chenon, became ill and was unable to make the trip to New York City. The much-anticipated debut was changed from New York City to the Odeon. One can only imagine the excitement of that night, October 10th, 1926. Men in tuxedos and women in beautiful gowns emerged from chauffeured cars. Flashbulbs popped, and reporters scribbled furiously to record the glorious event. It is said that after that night, the Odeon's days were numbered. In 1939, after Father Bourgeois' death, Monsignor Henry Vincent sold the Odeon to a theater group. Eventually, the Odeon, the Paris-inspired mecca of theater and arts, built by a priest with vision and devotion, became a furniture store, with a barber shop in the once glamorous reception room. Today, there is a renaissance brewing in Arctic, thanks to men like James Belanger, Lloyd Felix, and David Vieira. They are the owners of a new theater in Arctic, the Arctic Playhouse, located at 117 Washington Street. Locals can once again experience live theater, films, concerts, art shows, and a host of other attractions at the Playhouse. Like Father Bourgeois before them, Belanger, Felix, and Vieira are on a mission to improve the lives of residents by restoring an important part of life and history to Arctic, theater.
My dad was born in Fall River. His parents came over from the Azores, St. Michael, in around the turn of the century. And they settled in Fall River, and then that's where he was born. And then they moved to West Warwick. And they raised 10 children. Yeah, Dad used to tell us different things about when he was a kid. And, you know, when you're a little kid, back in the 30s, you made money because, you know, they were going through a depression. So he did things like he was a shoeshine boy, or he carried ice up three floors to provide ice to people, because that's when they had ice boxes. They didn't have refrigerators. In 1942, he joined the military. Like most men, when the war broke out, he signed up and he joined the Airborne. The Airborne was quite a bit different. It had different training. And my dad wanted something not more rigorous, but he wanted something a little bit more special. So that's why he joined the Airborne. He was 21. Mm-hmm. And at that time, he was one of the older guys. Mm-hmm. So he joined the military and went through basic training, jumped into Normandy. I heard a lot of different stories, good stories and bad stories. He told me about some awful things. And some of the soldiers, the men coming home, did not talk about their experience, where I was pretty fortunate where my dad did. There's battles throughout the war that are significant and important. I wouldn't say that my father's unit did anything more outstanding than the other soldiers that fought on D-Day or in the Battle of the Bulge. After the war, they wrote a book about his unit. Stephen Ambrose, out of kind of a chance meeting, came to one of their reunions and talked to the men. Mm-hmm. Stephen Ambrose was a professor at Tulane University at that time. And from that chance meeting came his thought that this could turn into a book. My father had passed away. He passed away October 15th of 1998. And at that particular time, there was a grumbling that something was going on. They wasn't sure. People probably knew, but they didn't know at my dad's level. So the miniseries is coming out. The young actor who portrayed my father, Rick Gomez, did a fantastic job portraying my dad. And we didn't really know how big of a role my father would have. We didn't know it at all. So we really didn't, we didn't downplay it, we didn't upplay it either. So it wasn't until the series came out, and after each and every episode, we realized, wow, geez, Dad is in quite a bit of this. And it was just great recognition for, you know, our dads. And I think probably the most important part of this that my dad would say was it provided an opportunity for all of the other men who served to maybe tell their story. They all sacrificed, mm-hmm. And I've been blessed to have been to Normandy 6 times. Mm. And to go to the cemeteries, to visit the ones that didn't come home.
Hi there, my name is Jack Lancelotta. I'm the executive director of the JC Education and Library Foundation, which oversees the junior chamber here in the Kent County area. And people always ask about what is the JCs. And my best explanation is it's a young people's leadership training organization with an age range of 18 to 40 years old that focuses on the individual development of the person while they offer their skills and abilities to enhance community services. Here in West Warwick, the JCs have been involved in spearheading many tremendous projects way back into the 1950s.
Jack Lancelotta is a treasure for the town of West Warwick. He's been there, he never refuses to help. He and the JCs were very instrumental in two things you just mentioned. One is the expansion of the library, where they created the Education and Library Foundation, JC's Education and Library Foundation. And they were also very instrumental in River Point Park, which is the outdoor sports center and cultural center, really, because there's concerts there, there's all kinds of things there for the town of West Warwick. And along the way, they helped build a river walk, a nature walk. The former Senator Donnelly Rock Nature Way. He was a beloved senator that died many years ago.
And we're here at the award-winning JC Arboretum and Senator Rock Riverwalk. It's located within the River Point Community Park and a stone throw away from the West Bay bike path called the Washington Secondary Greenway. We have many beautiful activities here throughout the planting season from April all the way through the month of October. We have an ecology day where we bring vets, clergy. We have wonderful ceremonies with a lot of great volunteers. We also are one of the original organizations that have the commemoration for the very sad and somber 9/11 ceremonies that we work with our public safety officials and numerous other volunteers. We have a lot of great programs throughout the planting season with corporations, schools, summer volunteers and the like, and we can give you a little tour of the area of the many species of plants and shrubbery and trees that have been here since we inaugurated it in 1998. And continuing our tour of the West Warwick area, one of the initial and a most significant, if not landmark, initiatives that the JC started way back in 1958 was the movement to bring about a library association and an actual board of directors, which created the modernization and consolidation of a new library system here in the town of West Warwick.
The JCs always are on the ready for a call to help, and their help is invaluable. I mean, could the library expansion have happened without them? Yes, but not as easy. Could the River Point Park be what it is today? Yes, but not as easy, and probably not in that case, because The thing I notice now is that many years ago, if you had a call to help for volunteers, people would be pouring in to help. It's not as easy now. It's difficult to find volunteers, but the JCs are always there. Jack is always proactive, not reactive. And I would say without the JCs, West Warwick would be a different place.
They've been recognized statewide and even nationally through grants and awards, and very proud to be a leading organization on the civic level that brings about a lot of changes and improvements to their own towns and also to enhance the lives of many people, of today's youth and young people.
This is the main library, and currently it's the only library, and it's the Robert H. Champlin Memorial Library. Crompton Free Library was the first lending library in West Warwick, started in 1876. At the time, and I'm going to say late 50s, early 60s, there were five individual libraries in town. West Warwick is composed of small villages. It was a manufacturing town. Each village had a large mill that was the center of its own little universe, and each of these mills offered a library for their employees. Specifically Crompton, that library was built for the employees of the Crompton Mills. Crompton Velvet was manufactured here. There were, I think there's one in Phoenix, one in Natick, Anthony, Centerville, Crompton. It was decided that a central library was needed here. The town was growing. The schools are, we are closer really to the high school, the middle school. And it was just deemed necessary that there be a central location for the important materials of the town. One of the libraries, and I don't remember which one, had ownership of the Gleaner. The Gleaner was a newspaper that was published from Civil War through World War I or II. And there was, these were the original paper copies. And it was important that these things be in one place. So that was part of the JC's project. And Mr. Champlin, Robert Champlin, had left money and property to have a library built. He was a lumberman. He owned a large lumber company here. And so he was an important businessman in town. And we were just fortunate that he left us money and the property. $100,000, yes. And of course, after it sat there for a few years, it sat there for a few years. It ended up being $114,000 by the time we were able to use it towards the building. At that time, the state was just beginning their project where they would match funds for a build for a library. So we applied immediately because then we could build a better library for less money, truly. The JCs were really, really important with that. They helped us with the fundraising. They helped every step of the way. The dedication was in February of 1967. They opened, I believe, in the fall before that, 1966, I think, September, October, in that area. Some of the books came from the branch libraries that were closing. So we had books here from Phoenix. We had books here from Natick and Anthony. And that's when the Gleaner collection came. After they closed, I think it was Natick, but I'm not positive. And so the collection started there. And then we had some people donated books, and then you had a little bit of a book budget. What's here now that wasn't here 50 years ago? Computers. One library card for the entire state. E-Zone. Once again, Envision, we have the time print management. We have an IT librarian on staff, which would have been unheard of years ago. We have our outreach program so that to visit the elderly who are in, you know, not able to come to us, we go to them. We have a very, very active children's department, youth services department. It has changed. Traffic here has changed, but it's still a lot of traffic. They come in for the same and different. Not everyone owns a computer. Not everyone has a tablet. We offer that convenience to every member of the public.
I'm Cecilia St. Jean, and I've been a member of the Historical Society here for 25 years. The idea of starting a historical society in West Warwick generated at Club Frontenac with Senator Donald Rock, Ted Holmberg from the Kent County Daily Times, and others, as they talked about the old days and that something should be done to preserve that history. The founders were Clarence Kutu, Janice DeCandido, Elliot Healy, Theodore Holmberg, Bob Wood, Alan Howland, Thomas Quinn, and others. The first meeting was held at the home of Alice Morton, a teacher at the West Warwick High School. From there, the small group quickly grew to 40 or more, and meetings were held at the Centerville Methodist Church, St. Mary's Church, and other places. Dr. Morris Legue, a local optometrist, became involved and offered a small space in his building on Weaver Street. Bylaws were enacted, officers were elected, a society prayer was written by Father Edmund Fitzgerald from St. Mary's Church. Membership dues were set and donations started coming in. Money was needed. Dick Hughes and Carter Handy gathered photos, selected 12 featuring local scenes, and in 1988, the first calendar was printed. They quickly sold out. As more donations came in, space became an issue. Space was also an issue at the Crompton Free Library in a building which had been turned over to the town in 1945 by the management of the Crompton Mill. It soon outgrew its space, and in 1958, the West Warwick JCs spearheaded a movement to build a central library. 9 years later, in 1967, the new library was open to the public. The Crompton Library remained open until 1992. This bode well for the Historical Society, because by then it also was in need of larger quarters. Although some of the members were somewhat fearful of expanding and taking on debt for repairs to the building, but Dick Hughes and others worked with Mayor Michael Levake, and in 1993 obtained a lease from the town, and they moved into this building. Built in 1876 by the management of the Crompton Mill to promote education for their employees and other village residents, the building was structurally sound but needed refurbishing. Members started cleaning, dismantling bookcases, washing walls, shades, and the few pieces of furniture that were left in the building, and obtaining donations of used furniture and office supplies. In April of 1999, we received an award from the Rhode Island Historical Preservation and Heritage Commission for returning the once neglected building to splendid community use. We love to have anyone come in, and we're very grateful for any help that we can get, but mainly we love to have people come in and show them what we have. This year, we celebrate our 40th anniversary, and we want to thank all the members and those who have helped us with artifacts, memorabilia, and everything that they've done over those 40 years to keep the society going.
My name is Jerry Tellier, and I'm a retired battalion chief on the West Warwick Fire Department, served there for 28 years, and very interested in the history of the fire department and tell the story of the West Warwick Fire Department, how it got started, and we'll go from the beginning of when the town became a town. 1913, West Warwick separated from the town of Warwick, and at that time, all the fire departments in the town were strictly volunteer. There was the Warwick Coventry Fire Department, which had two stations, the River Point Fire Department, which had three stations, Phoenix Fire Department, which had one station, Natick Fire Department had one station, and the Crompton Fire Department, which had one station. November 5th, 1947, a permanent fire department became in effect for the town of West Warwick, and the volunteers assisted the permanent men as it all began. Chief Lionel Garrow was the first fire chief that was appointed to the West Warwick Fire Department, and that was our beginning. There was only two men that were paid prior to 1947, and one of them was Lieutenant Paul Bertrand, and the other was Chief Lionel Garrow. So everybody else was volunteers at that point. The purpose for the fire department, one is for fire protection, two, rescue service, three, public education, four, fire prevention. They respond to auto accidents, they respond to industrial accidents, hazardous materials, technical rescue, and medical emergencies, just some of the things that the fire department does. It's an insurance that you hope you don't use. Some of the major incidents that occurred in the town of West Warwick over the years: February 15, 1971, L. Brayton Foundry and Company, 39 East Main Street. August 21, 1972, St. Ange Fire, downtown Attic on Main Street. October 3, 1972, the Crompton Grain Mill Fire, 8 Bridge Street. May 12, 1987, Agway Petroleum Fire on Hay Street. May 15, 1992, Crompton Stone Mill, 100 Pulaski Street. February 20th, 2003, Station Nightclub Fire, 211 Cuisset Avenue, 100 people died. March 31st, 2005, Phoenix Mill Fire on 771 Main Street. On November 3rd, 1959, we lost a firefighter. It's called a line of duty death. Captain Joseph Lionel St. Jean died in a house fire, 254 New London Avenue. He was fighting a fire. He didn't come out. The guys went in. They found him in a cellar, and he succumbed to his injuries. On October 11, 1965, we lost a volunteer firefighter, Joseph Ventura. He battled a fire at the West Warwick Junior High School, which is now the Horgan Elementary School on Providence Street. He left the fire. He went home. He had a heart attack. And the story is that he still had his boots on when the guys got to him. So West Warwick has had two line of duty deaths in their history. October 14, 2012, West Warwick firefighters built a memorial up at their station 4 on 110 Quesett Avenue. All of the firefighters that have passed through the West Warwick Fire Department, and as they deceased, we put their names there, their families come, they unveil their name. And that's a way that we remember these people. We do not want to forget anyone. And hopefully, we never have to bury another firefighter.
The West Warwick Police Department was established on November 8, 1913, with the appointment of Theodore S. Andrews as the first chief of police. Pictured here is the badge that he wore in 1913. The original force consisted of the chief and five patrolmen. Andrews was an experienced lawman, having been a constable in East Greenwich from 1898 to 1902, then being appointed as the chief of police for the town of Warwick. When Warwick was divided into two separate towns, Andrews elected to work in the fledgling town of West Warwick, as River Point was where he made his home years earlier. Andrews worked closely for many years in law enforcement with his friend, Michael Lynch, who appointed him as a Kent County deputy sheriff in 1903. Lynch was not only Andrews' second in command of the police department, but also Andrews' boss as the Kent County High Sheriff. Pictured here is the badge Andrew wore as a Kent County Deputy Sheriff. The first police station in West Warwick was located at 11 Pike Street, the Kenyon Pike Mansion. This building was ceded to the town and was used as a town hall for many years. Chief Andrews and several other chiefs had an office in this building before moving to a tenement house at 1190 Main Street in the 1920s. This police station was moved one lot north in 1928 when the U.S. Postal Service purchased a corner lot to build the new post office. The present-day police station was built in 1959 as part of the Veterans Memorial Building, which houses the police department, town hall, and the fire station. The police side of the building was built when the department had 20 members. In the 1990s, it housed as many as 63 officers. Pictured here is the original neon WWPD sign. It hung on the old police station as well as the current station for many years. As far back as anyone can remember, at least to the 1870s, there were also several buildings in the villages of Western Warwick that were referred to as lockups. These were town buildings that contained holding cells where prisoners were held overnight after being arrested. These were located in Lippitt at the location of the current fire station across from the Lippitt Mill, in Centerville at the current FOP Lodge in Murray Square, and in Arctic in the basement of a house on Curzon Street, which is kind of lost to history at this point. Shown here is a first issue West Warwick police badge from 1913. These three badges are second issue badges from the early 1940s. The West Warwick Police Department has used several different styles of uniforms over the years. Traditionally, the uniform has been blue from 1913 to 1973, when it was changed to black and gray. This was the year the distinguished red dress blouse and red traffic shirt were introduced for ceremonial purposes. The West Warwick Police Department has used many different types of vehicles over the years. Here are photos of some of them. There were eight police chiefs in West Warwick between 1913 and 1948. They had various levels of law enforcement experience, and most in the teens and 20s were appointed more on a basis of political association than on police experience. In total, 19 officers have held the title of West Warwick Police Chief in our 103-year history. This is a photo of the West Warwick Police Department in 1940 between the old police station and the old post office. This is a photo of the department today, taken in the same location 76 years later. These are our officers. This is our story.
Draw people. This is very good. We come here every summer. We look forward to it. My husband has a lot of relatives that are here. We have friends that are here, and it's a nice place to meet people.
Everybody gathers together. A lot of people end up getting up and dancing, which is very entertaining.
Connecticut would come down and go shopping to all these shops in the biggest town around at that time.
When I was younger, my mother would bring us to this town, and it was a big deal to come to this town to go shopping. A lot of nice stores.
Well, I was born here, and I went to school here, and I remember when Arctic was a bustling shopping center before the malls were built. And on Friday nights, you were four deep on the sidewalks.
You had J.J. Newberry's, which was kind of like a variety type store, and they had a soda fountain, and then you had the Wiener Joint. So you had a lot of different type of stores there that you could walk around and stuff like that. So it was the hub of it, and you had banking and restaurants and things, so.
It's just a very strong, rich cultural town that, you know, if there's a fire or a family's displaced, the West Warwick Senior Center literally has to put out notices saying we have enough. We can't take any more. It's a close-knit community.
Our town, West Warwick, is made possible by the following premier sponsors.
Centerville Bank, providing a wide array of financial services since 1828. Proud supporter of Rhode Island PBS, our town, West Warwick, and the community.
And
John J. Clark Insurance, established in 1928, committed to the West Warwick community and beyond, conducting business with integrity and professionalism.
And the following patron sponsor.
Iannotti Funeral Home.